presented at the beginning, and then a series of variations follow. These three chorales are beautiful, beautiful pieces, which I love playing. And of the three, I love playing the first one the most. I remember probably one of the most important concerts of my life when I was a young man just happened to be in Washington National Cathedral. And it was the first time that I had performed this Franck chorale. And although I didn't play it particularly well, it was a kind of auspicious occasion that gave me confidence to believe that I would have a career as a performer. And I owe a lot of that debt of thanks to Franck for writing such beautiful music for the organ that I feel in tune with in a lot of ways. But I'm not the only one. Vierne felt exactly the same way about Franck, and indeed was a student of Franck at the Paris Conservatoire. When Franck passed away in 1890, Vierne was just 20 years old, but it took a lot out of him. He was very, very sad to lose Franck as a mentor, a teacher, and a friend. And in many ways, his compositions for the organ themselves remind me so much of Franck, and I'm sure that Vierne was thinking of Franck as he wrote his own beautiful music. Vierne, of course, became, after a most interesting, varied, and not altogether happy life, organist of Notre Dame Cathedral in Paris. And while that's a fantastic appointment, to be sure, the organ at the time was in terrible condition. And in the 1920s, Vierne, who by this point had completely lost his sight, embarked on an international tour of recitals, if you will, that took him to other parts of Europe, but also to the United States. And it was during these tours that he wrote his 24 pièces de fantaisie, four suites of pieces of five or six movements each, and each of the movements is dedicated to someone he encountered along the way. And I've presented music from three of the four suites this afternoon in a little suite of its own. The prelude is from the first fantasy suite, and it is a beautifully effervescent, peaceful, and impressionistic work that I think shows the lighter side of Vierne. The second work, which comes from the third suite, is his Hymn au Soleil. There's a lot of soleil out there today, so perhaps he was inspired by the visions of that brightness that happens at the end of the summer, the beginning of the autumn, where the sun is so explosively big and bold when you look at it after it rises in the morning. And so this Hymn au Soleil is an extremely confident and quite strident celebration of that light. The third work, Cathédrales. This work reminds me of all of the four that I'm playing of Franck most specially. And it reminds me as well of a work by Debussy, which also has a vision of a cathedral that kind of emerges in the mist. And as you come closer to it, you see it in all of its vivid beauty and glory, its grandeur and majesty, and how magnificent it is. And in this work, we get closer and closer to that cathedral until we see it right before us. And then as we drift further and further away, we contemplate the majesty that we've witnessed. And many of Franck's compositions give me that same vibe, and in that regard, I say it's very similar to Franck. And lastly, perhaps Vierne's most famous piece is Carillon de Westminster, which, as the title suggests, is based on the Westminster chime, and the work is dedicated to Henry Willis of the English organ building family. So there's a little bit of the affection that Vierne had for some of the people that he encountered on his journeys. So once again, thank you for being here. Our soup today is another magnificent offering, and it'll be leek and potato, so do join us in the curry room at the end of the concert. There'll be plenty of soup for everyone. And again, I just wanted to say that I'm very sorry that we can't present Megan this afternoon, but as soon as she is feeling better, we're going to ramp up that recital program again and present it a little bit later in the season. So thank you for being with me. I hope you enjoy the music.